they on?
They're right there. The switch for those are right there.
No.
The ones up there, right under the picture.
Well, good evening. The 1890s were an exciting and pivotal time for the Herreshoff Manufacturing Company. New Navy contracts for torpedo boats came in, the first of which was for the 138-foot Cushing shown here. Clients of means were ordering fast steam yachts, like the Javelin, by the dozens. New shops were being built and outfitted in support of the company's growth and as a reflection of its profits. In 1893, the Herreshoff would design and build the first of a long line of America's cut defendants, starting with Vigilant, which you see here. Although even the brothers may not have predicted the dramatic shift in emphasis a century ago, it would come to pass that their major clients would soon be yachtsmen sailing fast sailboats, ordering fast sailboats rather than clients ordering powerboats. But before we talk more about the halcyon days when the Herreshoff Manufacturing Company was speeding toward its zenith, let's try to understand a little about where it was 100 years ago. Like any successful business, the Herreshoffs succeeded because of a demand for their product and of having the capability to meet that demand, and finally, by working with enough efficiency to make a profit. Demand, capability, and efficiency. The Herreshoff brothers excelled in all three. J.B. Herreshoff began building boats on his own about 15 years before he and N.G. formed the Herreshoff Manufacturing Company. He adapted this existing building, known as the Old Tannery, across the street from the Herreshoff Homestead to become his workshop. And in 1863, at age 22, he hired some men and went about looking for clients. Thomas Clapham was the first customer. He ordered a TV room. The white sloop was hauled out on the bank in this 1866 photo. Clapham's first Geneva was a converted sandbagger, unbeatable, so he thought. But she was no match for J.B. Herreshoff's 27-foot sloop Kelpie, which he had modeled and built and sailed by himself. Although J.B. was sightless and needed some help, he did, in fact, developed the shapes of many of the boats that came out of his shop in those days before there was a Herreshoff Manufacturing Company. The demand for J.B. Herreshoff's sailing craft came through continued successful racing against other boats, especially other boats of well-heeled yacht clubs and individuals, which of course he saw as potential customers. Fighting The 34-foot sloop shows here in the doorway, and shown again here, brief down in the breeze, was widely known for the speed. The pilot, this one modeled by Captain Knapp, was another. Sadie, raised both as a sloop and as a schooner. Van Herreshoff himself campaigned Iampi, this 52-foot schooner built by his blind brother, all one summer, to spread the word and promote J.B.'s business. And of course, there was a 34-foot Shadow, famous, owned and raced so many years by the Bryant family in Boston Waters. Her many victories showed up time and time again in the newspapers, and her reputation survives to this day. Headlines were made in 1885 when the Herreshoff brothers, as well as other members of that close-knit competitive family, ran their 85-foot steam yacht, Stiletto, against the cracked Hudson River steamer, Mary Powell. Her conclusive win brought an accolade, real front page stuff, that was better by far than any kind of paid advertising. I think this came off the top of a cigar box. The Navy became interested. They purchased Stiletto and hired the Herreshoffs to convert her to a torpedo boat. William Randolph Hearst ordered the 112-foot Famoose, which would slip along at close to 30 miles an hour. He wrote Stiletto in one of his own newspapers. While quite possibly Famoose was the fastest thing afloat in the world when she came out a century ago. On his own, N.G. Herreshoff entered the catamaran building business in a part of the old cannery for a few months just before he and J.B. joined forces. This was his brochure, brazenly promoting his patented catamarans. To quote from it, "I now take pleasure in informing the lovers of aquatic sports that I am prepared to furnish them with a new and valuable accession to their resources. The catamaran is notably fast, safe, and comfortable. No careening, no wetting of jackets, no shifting of ballast. In short, sailing in them is the perfection of enjoyment." Unquote. In 1880, a couple of years after N.G. and J.B. became partners, the brothers offered their 100-foot steam yacht, Wheeling, the largest yet built by the Fledgling Company, and one which had just been traded in for an even larger vessel, offered her to the Navy for testing. Free. She was furnished complete for the Herreshoff's own crew, and the brothers covered all the operating costs. Half patriotism, perhaps, but surely clever promotion as well. The Navy report on Leela fairly sparkled with praise and led to contract awards for half a dozen new torpedo boats, besides Cushing of 1890, the first slide which you've already seen. There were a pair of 175-footers, Newport and Porter, of 1895, the 140-foot Morris following them, and the twin 100-footers, Gwynn and Talbot, of 1897. Now, these were not Navy designs, like the military vessels of today, but designed right here in Bristol by Captain Knapp himself. The personal touch also helped keep up the demand for new boats by taking the wealthy and boat-crazy E.D. Morgan for sail in his 35-foot cruising cat yacht Clara. Captain Knapp received an order then and there for Pelican, as well as her near sister Gannett, both somewhat similar to Clara, and one whose performance so impressed Morgan that he went on ahead with Gloriana the very next year. Now, the irony of this chain of events was that Gloriana, in only 8 races, sailed during the summer of 1891, brought the Herreshoffs a record reputation in sail, equal to what had taken them a dozen years to achieve in steam. Gloriana's victories, coupled with the death in 1891 of Edward Burgess, who was the country's then leading designer of racing sailboats, left N.G. Herreshoff virtually unchallenged in the field of sailing yacht design, and brought in a flood of new orders, the first of which was just beginning to be felt just about a century ago now. To keep up the demand for them, Herreshoff boats had to perform, and perform they did. A lightweight hull was the chief reason. Just look at how Vanessa was built. This 30-footer's hull is only a half inch thick, and her deck is even thinner. The plan says, make it a scant half inch. This is incredible that a hull and a deck this thin really sounds like more like a fiberglass boat or a modern pole molding. And in a way it is, and the topside planking is in two layers, stuck together with shellac as well as screws. 1/4-inch thick cedar came first, and then an outer skin of the same thickness mahogany, because this hull was to be varnished. The deck planks, although of single thickness, joined each other with marine glue and copper cloth nails at their shiplap edges. Vanessa's steamed oak frames are tiny, only about the size of a beetle cat's frames at their top, but they taper and become bigger in cross-section as they get to the bilge where more strength is needed. In width, the frames taper and get smaller toward the stern and in the overhanging bow. Bronze strapping reinforces the thin deck. These were featherweight hulls, no doubt about it. Vanessa's 30-foot, 6-inch hull weighed only 1,400 pounds. The boat's sail-carrying ability came mostly from its 2,000-pound ballast keel, connected to the hull by means of a bronze plate. But these seemingly fragile craft stood up to wind and wave without distress. Here's We Win, now on the overhead and back of it, built the same year as Vanessa, and now celebrating 2 years beyond, actually, her centennial. Halsey found her in England and shipped her home, where she served to prove just how strong one of the Herreshoff's hulls are. After years of racing, We Win has neither lost her shape nor broken her delicate structure. She's smaller than Vanessa, and her hull and deck are only 3/8 of an inch thick. And frame heads are tiny, only 5/8 of an inch square. N.G. Herreshoff grew up fully aware that in order to go fast, the sailing yacht had to be able to carry a large rig, and to do so, she had to be stable. His father, Charles, always rigged a lid-filled ballast box, which could be rolled on a track from one side of his catboat to the other, where it could be locked up to windward. Charles is not racing here, so the ballast box is not aboard, but when it was rigged, this benefit was readily apparent. The need for stable sailing hulls became an important part of N.G. Herreshoff's family heritage. In the unbeatable sloop Shadow of 1871, in order to get the inside ballast as low as possible, Nat Herreshoff came to use a wine glass-shaped midsection. Although this made for an exceptionally beautiful hull, those many bars of lead stowed deep in the bilge were an important factor in Shadow's racing prowess. Later, Captain Nat's patented catamarans approached stability in another way, from the spread of their two hulls. They became a stable platform of ultra-light weight, which allowed speeds 2 or 3 times that of the same size monohull. Still later, N.G. Herreshoff overcame local traditions and discovered the advantage of outside ballast. Consuelo, of 1883, his first family-sized cruiser, which followed on the catamarans, was one of the very first yachts in the country to shed the bilge ballast completely. With a displacement of 21,000 pounds and a lead keel of 13,000 pounds, Consuelo's ballast ratio was an incredible 61%. This same high ratio of outside ballast had a lot to do with Gloriana's success. She could carry full sail when other heavily built yachts had to reef. Now, let's talk about sails. Captain Knapp had his own ideas about how they could be improved. Knowing that canvas stretched a lot less across its width than along its length, he figured the sails would hold their shape better if the cloth ran at right angles to the leech instead of parallel to it, as had always been the custom. Even with cup defenders and cup contenders like Polonia, whose picture we see here, the brothers decided to have their own awning maker, Asa Hathaway, make such a mainsail as an experiment. Captain Knapp became convinced that this cross-cut mainsail theory was good, so good, in fact, that the new cup sloop Defender should have such a sail. But not a single commercial sail maker would have anything to do with this idea. So, in typical fashion, the Herreshoffs set up a sail loft in the attic of the North Construction Shop. And awning maker Asa Hathaway built Defender's mainsail right here in Bristol. A sail that proved so much better than the alternate up and down cut sail ordered by the skeptical Defender Syndicate that Defender sailed with it exclusively for the entire 1895 season. The cup stayed once again on this side of the Atlantic. From then on, the Herreshoffs made all their own sails with a cross cut pattern like the mainsails for this 20-rated Niagara, shown here. She went to England and showed her heels to fleet after fleet, and before long, others followed, and the cross-cut sail became the standard. This entire discussion could be about performance and its effect on the demand for Herreshoff yachts, both steam and sail. But it's time now to consider how this relatively small company was able to build all the boats it began receiving orders for. The yacht's capability was limited in the beginning, as it had been throughout JB's 15-year tenure. As we've already seen, an existing building known as the Old Tannery on the shore in front of his parents' home served as a workshop, but it was small, dark, and ill-suited. JB added on to it as his business expanded, and ran a dock out into deeper water as well. He also purchased the old Burnside Rifle Factory and used it as a machine shop and for building small craft as well as for sawing logs into lumber. But when he and Ingy joined forces in 1878 to form the Herreshoff Manufacturing Company, things were in rather bad shape. Not only was there an inadequate facility for manufacturing boats efficiently, but J.B. was in debt. Part of the brothers' founding agreement was that once the bills were paid, the company would fund any further expansion through its earnings. Never again would credit be dependent upon to buy materials, or to build shops, or to buy machinery. Slowly at first, and then more rapidly, the company did grow, even under this conservative approach. This is its first year, 1878. 4 years later, in 1882, the building ways were still sheltered only by an awning, and it was necessary to construct large vessels like this 126-footer out of doors. Next year, in 1883, however, the old cannery was replaced by a fine new construction shop, built by the yard crew to Captain Knapp's design. It shows just in back of the Capitol of Julia. The 165-foot long by 35-foot wide shop was a vast improvement, a state-of-the-art building that anyone of us boatbuilders would be happy to have today. Captain Knapp believed that good work couldn't be done right in poor light. So there were rows of big windows, and the walls and the overhead were painted white. There was, of course, a big door and lashing ways at the water end over the photographer's shoulder. Soon to the north, another construction shop was built, almost a duplicate of the first one. The twin buildings became the focal point of the entire company, and all launchings of any consequence took place through one or the other of these two waterside doors. Still further to the north, and stretching ultimately to the road, was the mill building, which housed the planers, sawers, shapers, and other machinery for converting rough sawn wood into finished dimensions. On its second floor was a joiner shop, where panel bulkheads, trunk cabins, hatch covers, and self-healing cockpits were made as sub-assemblies. Steam from the central boiler room at the front end of the mill ran machinery on both floors by means of a stationary steam engine driving a series of flat leather belts. One by one, more buildings were erected. To the old rifle factory was added a wing for a machine shop. A new boiler shop was built in 1881. There was a foundry where lead keels were poured, iron castings were made for steam engines, and lovely bronze hardware was created. In time came a sail loft, a forge shop, an upholstery shop, a paint shop, a horse stable, an electrical shop, and a couple of storehouses for the raw materials that were carried as inventory. The East Construction Shop came in 1902. J.B.'s old home was converted to become an office and drafting room. And by the late 1880s, J.B. and N.G. each had new homes at opposite ends of the company's holdings. J.B.'s house was just off the left edge of the screen at the head of Burnside Street. And N.G.'s was on the waterfront, also just off the screen at the upper right. Their parents, Charles and Julia, still lived in the homestead about halfway between. The brothers had created for themselves a little universe where their wonderful boats could be fashioned from raw materials. Here they were virtually independent, and the possibilities for quickly bringing new ideas to fruition were nearly unlimited. In general, the twin north and south construction shops were only used for assembling boats from the pieces that were made up elsewhere. Frames and planking and decking would arrive from the mill, the left-hand building below the plume of steam. These pieces would come into the shop all sawn out and planed to the proper thickness and width for the job at hand. In this 1888 photograph, by the way, 1898, you can see where the south construction shop at the right of the picture has been lengthened to accommodate the 175-foot torpedo boats that were built there a few years earlier. That's the Cut Defender Columbia at the dock. Steel frames could be made up in the south construction shop, would show up in the south construction shop, having already been heated and bent to shape. This is Petura, the largest of the nine great steel hull schooners taking form. Her 162-foot length came close to matching that of the shop. There'd be all kinds of beautifully crafted sub-assemblies sent down from the joiner shop, cabin trunks like this one, and hatches and skylights, as well as raised panel doors, berth fronts, and bulkheads. Ballast keels were cast in the foundry, then delivered, ready to fit and install. Engines and boilers and tail shafts and propellers would show up complete, having been manufactured right there on the premises. And anchors, gleaming bronze bow jocks, cleats, flagpole sockets could be ordered from the Herreshoff built inventory as each new boat required them. When a boat had been completed, it couldn't be left in the shop. It had to be cleared away to make room for assembling the next one. Big ones, like the torpedo boat pushing, were simply slid out the door on launching ways, regardless of the season. This is January of 1890. In the dead of winter, it didn't seem to make much sense to launch the smaller ones, however. So boats like the Bar Harbor 31s of 1904 were rolled onto the company's loggia and hauled by horse to the Walker's Cove Yard, where they were covered and could be stored until spring. We've talked about facilities, not the people. The skilled boat builders and machinists. The spy makers and blacksmiths. who came together within this self-contained enclave to produce the yachts that N.G. Herreshoff designed. Besides being skilled at their primary trade, many of the men were versatile, and throughout the ad, there was a strong work ethic. In a sense, the place was a factory, but in another, it was very much a craftsman's guild. I expect you're all familiar with this photograph of five of these men posing in front of a nearly completed 26-foot sloop Illyrian that Captain Nash ordered for himself in 1912. Second from the left is a 16-year-old young man named Charlie Sylvester. Charlie's career at Herreshoff was typical. His father had worked there until he died in 1905. Then Charlie himself joined the company only a few months before this photo was taken in the spring of 1913, and Illyrian was his first assignment. He was given the task of planing the hull smooth and fair while it was still upside down. He did the best he could, but his boss, Ernest Alder, the man at the left of the picture, told Charlie that his work wasn't good enough. So Charlie went back with his plane and learned, as did all new employees, that there was unwritten standards that had to be met. I had the honor and privilege of spending a good many hours with Charlie Sylvester near the end of his life and got an incredible insight into how the company built its boats. Barry Thomas was with me on most of those visits, and Barry went on to build one of the Herreshoff designed dinghies at Mystic Seaport, using what Charlie had taught him. Barry wrote a book about what he'd learned and done. A few years after that, by making use of what Charlie had taught me, I built a boat, the Joel White design, Haven 12 and a half footer, and used the Herreshoff method of construction. Like Barry Thomas, I also wrote an instruction book. Without access to Charlie Sylvester, neither Barry nor I, nor the people who read our books, would have anywhere near the understanding of how things work in this great company. They were as good as there was with Charlie's understated description of the men who built Herreshoff boats. And Charlie later became one of them himself as he gained experience. A short time after Illyrian was finished, he helped build the first fleet of the famous Buzzard's Bay 12 and a half footers. In fact, eventually, Charlie Sylvester came to be in charge of their construction. For nearly 30 years, Charlie worked at Herreshoff, and I know it pleased him to share with us some of his knowledge and feelings about the place. The only company employee record I've come across was the year 1899, when about 250 people worked here. 100 of them were carpenters. There were about 60 steel fabricators who framed and plated the metal hulls, 30 machinists, 30 boilermakers, 13 blacksmiths, 12 sailmakers, and 8 foundrymen. The standard work week was 60 hours. For all this workforce and for all the boats being built here, there was an office staff of only 3. And a design department consisting of 4 draftsmen, George Owen and Alpheus Packard among them, besides Captain Nat himself. So you can see that the office and drafting room were incredibly lean, at least by today's standards. This is an excellent time to bring up third element, efficiency. It goes right along with demand and with capability that I've talked about up until now. Almost everyone who worked for the Herreshoff Manufacturing Company produced some part of an end product, some item that found its way into the boats being built and sold. Certainly, this is a kind of efficiency. Streamlined communication was another. N.G. Herreshoff was the superintendent, and instead of having his foreman meet in his office and give him reports, he found out what was going on by walking around the shops. Routinely, once or twice each day, he inspected the work himself. If things were going awry, he saw to it that they were back on track right then and there. If there was a question on the intent of a particular detail shown on a particular drawing, and there were drawings for just about everything, he gave his official interpretation. New ideas and suggestions could come from the workers directly to him without memos or reports. detail, he knew what he wanted. Be it a boiler, a steering gear, a keel timber, or a mast mount. He designed it himself with a clear idea of just how it could be built most efficiently and still do its job, as well as satisfy the prevailing standards for aesthetics and durability. Most likely, he'd even built something like it with his own hands in the past, because before he reached the age of 30 years, Engie Herreshoff had become skilled at working in both metal and wood. There were, of course, some failures along the way, but with them came a better understanding of how the designs and construction techniques could be improved. J.B. Herreshoff came into this world filled with energy and ambition. From that fateful day in 1856, when he lost his sight at the beginning of his 15th year, J.B. Herreshoff engaged his kid brother, Nat, who at the time was only 7, and pressed him into service. And he never let up. In the beginning, Nat became J.B.'s eyes and was expected to do what for him must have seemed at times impossible. He guided J.B.'s hands while half models were being carved or turnings were being made on his lathe. The brothers sailed together day in and day out, with young Nat doing the seeing where J.B. could not, and making judgment calls, and generally taking on a responsibility that was far beyond his years. That same relationship between the brothers, of J.B.'s taking N.G.'s help somewhat for granted, and of N.G. rising to meet his older brother's demands, never ceased. This is J.B. Herreshoff in 1865 at age 24, after he had already begun his own business of modeling and building boats. Here at about the same time is 17-year-old Captain Nan, ready for schooling at MIT and a 9-year career designing steam engines for the Corliss Engine Company in Providence before he and J.B. became partners. As men and as partners, it was J.B. who would make the commitment to build this boat or that one and tell to N.G. to see that it got done. Here is J.B. at age 73, less than a year away from his death, through heart failure in 1915. And here is Captain Nat in semi-retirement in 1920. Because there was so much expected of him as a child and a young man, it wasn't long before Captain Nat became extremely proficient in whatever he did. He left behind an astonishing volume of work. His death came in 1938 at age 90. Let's take a quick look at how Engie Herreshoff designed a boat. Hull shapes came from wooden models rather than from lines drawn on paper. Over the course of his long life, he made in the neighborhood of 600 cat models, about 300 of which resulted in actual boats. By far the majority of the 2,000 or so boats that Herreshoff Manufacturing Company produced during its 60 years in business started with a half model made by Captain Nat. Needless to say, he became efficient in making them. And for him, developing a new hull shape this way was considerably faster than drawing a lines plan. Full models, as well as half models, could be made for testing new hull shapes for resistance and waveform, as Captain Nat is doing here, crouching on an observation platform which hangs from the bow of his powerboat, where it's out ahead of any disturbing wake. On a calm day, the whole ocean became his test tank. I've heard and read various theories on why Captain Nat found it best to create designs for models, but surely the most compelling is the need to communicate with his blind brother. By means of a model, J.B. could see through feeling. We have to remember that the Herreshoff brothers were partners, and that in the early days, J.B. did model boats by himself, albeit with some assistance. He was every bit as eager to explore a new boat shape as Captain Nat or anyone else. N.G. Herreshoff made lovely and very accurate models, mostly from white pine. These are two. The one at the top was created for the fin keel of Drusilla. Then, by remeasuring that same model with a different scale, the smaller fin keelers Winona and El Chico were built. III came out in 1892, along with a fourth boat named Hansel, which utilized Priscilla's molds, spaced closer together to produce a shorter boat. The lower boat, the lower model was used for Vanessa and Rita, two more thin keelers. Here is how N.G. Herreshoff measured the half models that he built. This machine, designed by him and built by the Brown and Shaft Company in Providence over a century ago, measures at each frame the heights and half breadths that will be recorded in the offset booklet that Captain Nash prepared for the man who will be launching the boat, that is, laying her lines down full size on the molded off floor. From the lofted lines, in turn, came the molds and the patterns which gave the hulls and some of its pieces their proper shape. One dial is for height above the baseline, and the other is for half breadths, or the distance out from the boat's center plane. They read somewhat like the hands of a clock, with the hour hand reading the scale equivalent of feet, and the minute hand reading the inches and eighths of inches. Scales could be changed simply by installing new dial faces over the ones shown, so it was an easy matter to convert the proportions of a given model for lofting it as a slightly different shape. And believe me, this changing of scales was frequently done, as we shall shortly see. The boat's frames themselves served as stations, and for a given frame, one begins by taking measurements at the sheer, like this, pushing the measuring arm out until its point touches both the surface of the model and the little piece of wood that Halsey, who graciously agreed to this demonstration of his father's device, holds against the shear with his left hand. The machine will even draw the shape of any given hull section on paper by means of this pantograph. Can we get focused a little bit better on that, Mike? Which mounts on the same running gear as the offset measuring device. Now remember, although there were no lines plans developed by Captain Nat, he did draw and had his draft and finished construction plans, as well as numerous detailed drawings. In fact, the drawings of the Herreshoff Manufacturing Company, which are now held by the MIT Museum in Cambridge, consist of about 15,000 sheets. I said that Captain Nat was organized. His penchant for organization shows here, where all the pieces for his offset machine, the measuring arms, the dials, the alternate dial faces, and even the tools, are stored away in this little wooden box when they're not being used. Here are two beautiful half models, both made for Universal Rule Racing sloops of the boat 1910. The lower model produced only one boat, which is the P-class sloop, the Locker. The top one, however, was used for three boats, and each of them was slightly different from the other. In fact, not one of the three boats ended up having the same proportions as the model. Dorothy Few used the original bow, which after measuring was sawn off. It shows here as a separate piece. A new and longer bow shape was then fashioned, and Eleanor was measured with it. Both Dorothy Few and Eleanor are proportionally fatter than the models, in length being as 83% and beam and draft, 94% of what you see here. For the larger P-class sloop Seneca, Captain Nat held the model's scaled length to 1 inch equals 1 foot, but he increased the beam and draft measurements by the ratio of 15 to 12, some 8% greater than the model itself would indicate. This imaginative use of a single model is a sure sign of efficiency, but it's only the beginning of the story of the mileage that N.G. Herreshoff occasionally squeezed out of his half models. Designing through modeling is a Herreshoff tradition that goes back at least to 1833, when Father Charles F. Herreshoff designed his first catboat, Julian. His son, Nat, built on that heritage extensively, as we have seen. Well, Captain Nat's son, Sidney, who carried on as chief designer in the company's later years, continued with the same model-making tradition. And even today, Halsey uses the hat model to bring to life some of his ideas on hull shape. And we can change carousels, I guess, Mike. We've talked about efficiency in designing, now with construction. There was a tradition that was pretty much unique for the Herreshoff Manufacturing Company to build its boats, at least the small and medium-sized ones, of wood, upside down. First, the mold would be built for every one of the frames. They'd be set up and fed, then removed, carried to the steam box for the bending of the frames and the attachment of the connecting floor timbers. After planking and caulking and smoothing, the hulls would be hoisted clear and turned right side up. Each one of the three construction shops had traveling overhead cranes by which the hulls could not only be hoisted, as shown, but could be moved to any nearby location and set on their waiting ballast keels. The Northeast Harbor 30-class sloop, Santa, is an example of how quickly a boat can be built by this method. It's taken only 5 weeks to get to this point, and she's 47 feet long with full cruising accommodations. In another 5 weeks, Santa is out the door on a venerable low gear and launched for sailing trials in the dead of winter. Here's how the 12.5 footers were built. The hull on the left has had its frames bent and its floor timbers attached, and its backbone installed. The boat on the right, set up on a second set of molds, because this is a real high production run, has been planked and smoothed up and is about ready to be lifted off the molds and turned right side up. The rest of the production process shows here. At the left is a ballast keel and deadwood for the boat we just looked at. Can that focus come in a little bit? The boat in the middle is receiving her bulkhead and after deck, and the left-hand boat looks like she's having some padware installed. And the ones at the top are completed and are awaiting delivery. Here's the 55-foot yawl Avanti being turned over. These photographs give you an idea of the Herreshoff technique flipping over a good-sized hull. Over she goes. You can see the chafing gear and the pads against the shores, and the shores which will soon rest to hold the boat upright against the shores will rest. The molds have been left in this case, so that the hull doesn't become distorted. And here she is turned upright. Boats as large as the 72-foot New York 50s, like the one outside the door, were also built upside down. Here are two of the nine that were built in the winter of 1912 and 13. Even an occasional catamaran set up this way. To the men in the shop, building boats this way became a conditioned reflex, no matter what the size or the shape. In his later years, after Captain Nat's retirement, the company built boats like the Yawl Brendan for designers like Alden, who were unfamiliar with the Herreshoff methods. But although these craft were not designed with inverted hull construction in mind, they were still set up by the same shop standard. Now, before closing, I want to take you on a quick tour of the North Construction Shop during the winter of 1925 and 26. In November, the 65-foot schooner Mary Rose is being decked at the far end. In the foreground is a fleet fleet of two New York, is the first of two New York 40s to be constructed that winter. This one is narrowly and is 59 feet long, scattered about our S boats in various stages of completion. Now, less than 3 months later, the scene has changed noticeably. Narrowly has been planked and has been turned right side up. She's even had a bowsprit installed. The bow shows over the top of the second New York 40, Fragosa 2, which is out here in the boat hall, which is half planked. See how easily it goes with good visibility and a comfortable working position. Gravity helps because it's all downhand work. Tools rest on a batten that has been temporarily nailed to Rigosa's planking. This is the same day after the men have cooked for lunch. Rigosa, as you know, is now owned by Halsey and being restored. And I believe he plans to repeat the 1926 Bermuda race name. Here we are on the deck of Mary Rose, looking at the stern narrowly. Fish boats are being built now instead of S boats. You can see a fish plant sloop being worked on just under the schooner's port bow. So here we are at the end of the talk. This is the Herreshoff Company. Came to its end in 1945 after nearly 60 years in the building of some of the finest yachts the world has ever known. Many of its methods have application for us now, especially in the field of wooden boat building, but also, I believe, as an example to American business generally. Striving as did the Herreshoffs for that magic combination of excellence and production has been a guiding light in my life, just as has their high aesthetic standard. And the virtue of keeping things simple has merit anywhere, anytime. Thank you.
Truman said there would be a depression that would cure their hair. I remember that particular phrase.
They did try fiberglass.
Experimentally.
Yeah.
But that was all. Yeah.
They would have gone ahead if it had been successful. They bought a big autoclave. It was in the East Shop. And they cooked, well, 14 dinghies. And out of the 14, they got one good one. And the father said, that's a Mr. Halfpenny. That's it. That's enough. In fact, we claim to have the first fiberglass thing you ever made in that glass cabinet.
And you know, I was given one of the finished dinghies, and I so regret that we didn't keep it. It would have been a wonderful thing to have here in the museum. We didn't keep it.
There's a fine picture of you at age, whatever it was, 15 or so, growing
there. Yes, it's over here.
It's on the front of the wall.
Question here?
What was the largest number of employees they ever had at once?
Well, 450 in World War II.
Is the only one that I've
About 400
in World War II. Okay, well, you count that. But I think while I was building yachts, perhaps 200 is the highest number I've done.
You said that one year.
1899. But I suspect it was higher, perhaps.
But they had some slack period, because there was one slack period when my father and Charlie's special brother-in-law left. They went down and worked at Nevins for a while back in the 20s when they got the slack, and then it picked up spending. They wanted them, I think Jim Brown was the foreman. He wanted them to come back.
And they lost a lot of good men. I think Rufus Murray left at that time as well for Nevins.
Yeah, Rufus Murray was the head guy at Nevins.
He made Nevins into a top-notch builder, yep. The same way he'd done here.
And Charlie came briefly around that time for a
little bit. Yeah, he went out to work for
what? No,
not up in Granite Beach.
JB, a lot of blind, compared with an NGH. And he worked it all out in his head, and he added up all the materials, what they cost. He added up all the labor my cost, all in his head. And then at the end, he multiplied by two.
Did that result in an expensive boat, or one that was not much more than today?
A bit expensive.
That would be interesting study sometime, if you get the back, I'm sure that they'll like price.
Well, I think they paid the highest wages, and they brought the best materials, and they, JB was a bit of a shop trader. So they did have probably a little higher price than the other guys.
They had a reputation for high prices, but when you hear the New York 50 came out at $14,250, if you wonder, today you wouldn't even consider the $250 and you'd put an extra zero on it, at least.
And the top half footers were $450 in 1914.
Well, what did they were all designed by outside people, apparently.
That's right, but I think they did sort of probably some shop drawings, contract plans during the war. The last complete boat design, what do you think, Maynard? Maybe 1954? Probably by 1955.
There were a few boats that were unfinished that were working some best boats that were unfinished when the war came on.
Did they finish them?
What?
Did they then finish them?
No, they were held until we got the torpedo boats all built. And then when the war was over, they went back and finished it. But we did make some scars.
Probably Sandy's father.
Sure?
Sandy's father, Harry Town, probably finished them up.
Wasn't there a
fish
design on 31
that
hung around all during the war?
I believe so, and I do think it was finished after the war before they closed down. Oh, yes. Well, Maynard, we're very indebted to you for such a wonderful set of slides and insightful presentations, and I hope it's all on the video for posterity, and we're very grateful to you for coming all the way up here from Maine, and we thank you very much indeed.
Well, it's been a pleasure and an honor to find that your expertise in speaking. Without notes, I think you've done it that way.